Now we have treatment by criteria. Any death which from cardiac police heralded by abrupt loss of consciousness and within 1 hour of the onset of acute change in cardiovascular status, blood pressure rate, and pre-existing heart disease may or may not be present. And there are three natural elements. It is natural, rapid, and it is unexpected. Exceptions like unwitnessed death in which... So basically, as a disease, first there is a prodrome phase. The patient may not get symptoms like chest pain, palpitation, dyspnea, fatigue, UTD. Thereafter, the event occurs where the cardiovascular changes happens. Hypotension, arrhythmia, hypotension, chest pain, dyspnea, lightheadedness. And then the event occurs like sudden collapse, loss of effective circulation, and loss of consciousness. From that, either patient may get revived by layman CPR or EAEs, or if the failure of CPR or lack of any thought process involved, then biological death involves, and which due to failure of resuscitation or failure of electrical, mechanical, CNS function, which occurs from minutes to weeks. So the changes in the clinical status and up to 1 hour, the 1 hour is a time period, repeat period. So various studies have been done for this sudden cardiac death, and in the US population, 63% of cardiac deaths have been due to this sudden cardiac death, and overall 40-50% of that in overall mortality, 10% of total mortality corresponds to this. So epidemiology, overall 15% of all deaths, and roughly 50% of all cardiac related deaths are due to sudden cardiac arrest, and incidence is 1 to 2 per 1000 each year. Mean survival is out of hospital 10-20% average, and in high risk group patients like already pre-existing coronary CAD, the incidence is around 100 to 120 per 1000 per year. However, more than 2/3 of patients who die from sudden cardiac death are considered low risk, with either no known cardiac risk factors. So this we have kept in mind that most of the patients are falling in the low risk category. So we cannot identify that previously. Now this is the age related incidence. In adults, this is usually very less.
It cannot be true in elderly. Mm. You see, for a young, it's okay. Mm. But at age of 50, sudden cardiac arrest, yes, sir. There is a concomitant coronary artery disease.
Yeah, definitely. Yes, as soon as we start. So in adolescents less than 20 years, 0.001%. Now as the age increases, in general population more than 35 years, 1 per 500 to 1000. Whereas in advanced heart disease, already pre-existing heart disease, starting from the age of 45 to 50 years, 1 in 4 is the incidence. Very high.
So
common causes include coronary atherosclerosis, cardiomyopathies, valvular heart disease, related heart disease, and other causes like myocarditis, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, especially in the young athletes, long QT syndromes, right reticular dysplasia like ARVC, anomalous coronary artery anomalies, Brugada syndrome, and idiopathic VF. Now, short QT, complete heart block, family there. Commercial colleagues, which is chest wall trauma and idiopathic PT. And the last is the non-cardiac causes, like pulmonary embolism, intracranial hemorrhage, drowning, Pickwickian syndrome, drug-induced central airway obstruction, sudden infant death syndrome. You can see that 60-70% is due to ischemic heart disease. Second is structural heart disease. Third is 5-10%. Overall non-cardiac causes are miscellaneous. So, summarizing common risk factors of sudden cardiac death is prior episode of having BTEC. These are all the risk factors which puts the patient in high risk category. LV dysfunction, low EF, previous MI, non-CAD, family history, non-cardiomyopathy, non-case of congestive heart failure, long QT syndrome, and right ventricular dysplasia. These are all the common risk factors which
this comes later on, but see, when the event takes place, you do not know who is the driver.
The disease actually is how to approach the survivor of the cardiac.
You are seeing the patient dying, yes.
Yes.
You are not assessing even risk factor. You are just making him to survive. Yes. And once he survives, then the whole issue
comes. Yes, the topic is actually after the survival. So, at the time of arrest, all we have to do is the primary and secondary is CPR and like this. It's a different topic. This is how to approach a patient who already survived cardiac arrest and then how to evaluate further.
This is sudden cardiac
arrest or survival? Arrest means
death. Arrest means death.
Sudden cardiac arrest is survival. So, yeah, I would agree. Now, sudden cardiac arrest accounts for 30-50% of deaths in patients with heart failure, and risk of both arrhythmic and non-arrhythmic deaths can be reduced by chronic heart failure therapy, but still it remains high compared to matched individuals without heart failure. Now, transient reversible causes like acute ischemia, MI, anti-arrhythmic drugs, medications, electrolyte imbalance, heart failure should be ruled out. How to initially evaluate the patient? First of all, history and examination begins immediately after resuscitation, and first concern is identify and treat the reversible cause which can be found. Now, signs and symptoms which can be found immediately after the patient survival of cardiac arrest, like unconsciousness, no respiratory movements, no blood pressure, pupils begin dilating within 45 seconds, seizures, dead-like appearance, and lips and nail beds can prevent speech constipation. So prior diagnosis is important. Use of any medications previous has to be ruled out. Any toxin or AC drugs, antecedent drugs, systemic or palpic medication. And post-resuscitation, usually if patient has some amnesia, so is related to certain bystanders can also be brought into consideration. Now there is
exercise is again a big risk.
Yes.
Right? Especially young school boys or college boys. Going for sports.
CPVT is accelerated by
exercise. Ask a customer like that. For any sport person, lawn tennis one also, they are used to, you know, 1.5 hour of, you know, but sometimes what happened, they get extended. Due to long rally, get extended for 2 hours, two and a half hours, and then it becomes an unaccustomed exercise.
That situation, that young person's death, it's difficult to explain.
Actually, what happens in the gym with the active sports, we are not having a screening system before you. So people are doing extensive exercise, as he said. But still, if he has a broken arm or a long degree,
without assessment, even in the gyms,
it's not a very good idea.
USA, like they have a strict screening protocols.
No gym in this town which charges so much money has a difficulty. It is important, very important.
So, there may be various electrolyte abnormalities like magnesium potassium and should be ruled out acidosis. Electrolyte imbalance can be a precipitating factor which already pre-existing heart disease for QT prolongation. And now resting ECG is important immediately after survival, which can detect some ongoing ischemia or prior MI. Conduction system disturbances like abdominal block, complete heart block, PW syndrome, ARVC, PV syndromes, and hypertrophy cardiomyopathy. There are three basic ECG patterns which are cardiac arrest, ventricular tachyarrhythmia, like ventricular fibrillation, the sustained type of pulses, ventricular tachycardia, ventricular asystole or bradycystolic asystolic rhythm with extremely slow rate, and then there is a pulses electrical activity which is previously referred to as electromechanical dissociation. This is a type of ventricular asystole, and there is intermittent QRS complex. In between there is no minimal activity, and this should be considered as asystole. This is a type of ventricular tachycardia, and this is a ventricular fibrillation. It is complete absence of properly formed QRS, no obvious PVS, and this can think 10 to 30 seconds if the connection is not that, then patient may get permanent neurological damage. So probability of achieving successful resuscitation from cardiac arrest is related to interval from the loss of consciousness to institutional resuscitation efforts. The setting in which the cardiac arrest occurs, the mechanism due to VT, VF, electric, pulses, ejected, or asystole of cardiac arrest, and the clinical status before the cardiac arrest.
See, one important risk factor is the electromechanical dissociation. You see the monitor is showing the electrical activity.
But there is no heart cardiac system.
Right. You don't see the pulse.
Mm.
You see?
Yes, really.
Right? And the pericardial component is the response.
For probability of achieving successful resuscitation is when the mechanism is pulseless VT, the outcome is best. VF is the next most successful. And asystole and pulses will likely generate dismal outcomes. They have very low rate of survival. Now, how to evaluate for ischemic heart disease? For ACS patients, sudden cardiac arrest survival, immediately within 48 hours CAG should be done. And urgent PCA is also recommended to relieve ischemia. And survivor without evidence of ACS, CAG is necessary without any stable chronic CAV, arrhythmia due to scar, usually monomorphic VT. And in young patient without any identified cause, and coronary angiography may reveal some anomalous coronary arteries. And otherwise, it is not necessary in any other clinical cause. This is other identified. Now, for structural heart disease, EPO and can be ruled out for LV dysfunction, cardiomyopathies like hypertrophy, diabetic cardiomyopathy, ARVC, aortic stenosis. Limitations: there is some transient global dysfunction, LV dysfunction, immediately post cardiac arrest due to myocardial stemming. And therefore, ECHO must be repeated after 48 hours of resuscitation. Cardiac MR is also helpful in some situations like cardiomyopathy, ARVC, myocarditis, amyloidosis, sarcoidosis. Now, evaluation of elliptical heart disease like ion channelopathies, Brugada syndrome, long QT, short QT, and EP study is helpful in such cases. The abnormality of AV conduction, bradyarrhythmias, accessory pathways, inducible VTs, in patient stable CAD or LV dysfunction, myocardial scar, 3D mapping can help for scar responsible to for scar VT. And supraventricular arrhythmias, then no obvious evidence of ventricular arrhythmias, if we can reveal some supraventricular arrhythmias. Limitations are there: inducible arrhythmias with non-aggressive protocol are poorly tolerated. Inducible arrhythmias with aggressive stimulation protocol can induce VT, VF in person without cardiac disease too. And absence of any inducible VT, VF may not preclude ICD implantation in patients with sudden cardiac arrest survival. Exercise status is exercise that do not require routinely. However, it can assist in diagnosis with long QT syndrome and CPVT, which can trigger exercise, trigger arrhythmias from exercise. Ambulatory monitoring is done in patients with no other clear etiology has been found, like Holter monitoring. Pharmacological training is required when some uncertain etiology is there. ECG may be abnormal or some intermittent changes. Genetic testing is not comprehensive enough. Now, epinephrine for induction of CPVT is also helpful, and procainamide for induction of Brugada pattern. Idiopathic PS when there is no evidence of any structural atrial abnormality found in evaluation. Other minor cardiac anomalies like first degree heart block, transient heart block, T thickening of LV free wall, hypertension without LV hypertrophy, mitral valve prolapse, paroxysmal of persistent AF, and isolated ventricular premature beats. These are compatible with idiopathic VA because they itself they are not strongly related to these arrhythmias. Screening of family members is important for this various diseases. Neurological and psychological assessment is also beneficial to establish the extent of impairment resulting from arrest. And signs of poor outcome include the absence of pupillary reflex, corneal reflex, motor response to pain, motor. More than 24 to 48 hours. And post-traumatic stress disorder also has to be evaluated later on. So these are the non-invasive and invasive assessments. Mandatory are detailed clinical history and drug intake history, blood chemistry, resting ECG and ECO, angiography in ischemic etiology, EP study in both patients having some electrical disturbances. Other tests for toxicology, provocative test, and other selective test in required case where the fetal is not found is signal average ECG, barrel reflex sensitivity, heart rate variability, and genetic testing.